For more on the Philippines' efforts to gain access to a COVID-19 vaccine when it becomes available, we're now joined by Dr. Lulu Bravo, Professor Emeritus of the UP College of Medicine and Executive Director of the Philippine Foundation for Vaccination. Dr. Bravo, nice to see you again. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me, Carmina.
All right, the whole world gearing up to receive the vaccine against the novel coronavirus. And you've also heard the news about clinical trials being halted for one reason or another. How close are we really to developing the vaccine and its eventual distribution?
Well, actually, we are months now towards having the result of the initial advanced vaccine trial that have been done in the US and some parts of Brazil and the Latin America. And in fact, if you listen to the American news, you know, they were going to say that it will be available by November before the election. But realistically, we know, if you listen to Dr. Fauci, it should be available. The results will be available maybe sometime in November, but then it will have to have a period of time for manufacturing and distribution and really going after all the people that needs to have the vaccine. And that could take another 3 to 6 months.
3 to 6 months.
Yes.
All right. Here in the Philippines, the president has said that he has found the funds for mass vaccination. How massive will this undertaking be?
Well, you know, it's not easy to have this vaccine available right away when you need it on demand. It cannot be, because there are 7 billion population in the world. And in fact, if you have to come up with just 100 million doses, which is what America is trying to do, 100 million doses, that will only be for their population. It will take 6 months to produce that. So it's not easy to produce millions and millions of doses. And that's the reason why the WHO has come up with a kind of what they call the COVAX, which will give you an equity way of distributing the vaccine when it becomes available. You know, we respect the WHO announcement because, see, they were saying that if a vaccine becomes available, that is because it is effective, it is safe first. It is safe, it is effective. Then this vaccine will have to undergo a production. And the millions and millions and millions of people who will need it will have to be distributed evenly. That's what they say, equity. Not because you're poor or not because you're rich, you're gonna get it because you have the money to pay for it. This is what WHO is promising the world, actually, that it will have a sort of equity. But then it would just be 10%. What I'm hearing from WHO is that they might be able to give at least for the first year 10% of the population who needs it. The Filipinos, the population is 100 plus million. So that means 10 million. And 10 million is still enormous if you come to think of it.
Now, this is what's going to happen here in the Philippines, at least according to the president. He says the military will be the implementing arm of the mass vaccination. I want to get your thoughts on that first, before we proceed with the rest of our conversation.
Well, the thing is, maybe we need to really come up with a summit and discuss what needs to be done. Because WHO, in fact, already mentioned that it is the health frontliners who will have priority. Because, you know, if people get sick, who will take care of them? And if you do not give them the protection that they need, the people, the health frontliners, may just disappear. They will, you know, even now, there are already ongoing reduction of health frontliners, not only because they're being stigmatized sometimes, but because of the fatigue and the sickness, the illnesses that are overcoming them.
Yeah, because if you listen to the president, this is what he wants to happen. He said that the poor should be vaccinated first. Those who don't have money to pay for the vaccine will be vaccinated first. That's the priority, along with the Philippine National Police and then the armed forces of the Philippines. I understand that the WHO convention state that, as you said, it has to be the frontliners first. But if you have a president who says the military is going to be the chief implementer of the mass vaccination, then I guess it should follow that it's the military and the police who should have it first. What do you think about that?
Well, maybe, as I said, it needs kind of a summit, a discussion, and maybe the IATF, because the vaccine is not yet here, right?
And we have plenty of time.
Yeah, there's plenty of time. And there's plenty of time now to discuss all this. And I think the IATF, once they realize what will be the consequences or what will be the outcome if you start from here, I mean, this is a problem that will need a solution, that it does not have to be just one person making this decision. I know the president has all the power to do what he wants to do, but I think he's just also available to listen, because, you know, this is something that we all have to figure out. When it comes to vaccines, the Philippines is one of the countries with the highest vaccine hesitancy rate. In the Asian region, we have the highest vaccine hesitancy. And if you mandate vaccine to people, it may also not have a good outcome. Mm. We need to have a conversation. We need to listen to the people. Mm. We need to have a community engagement. When introducing a new vaccine, it is important. And this, actually, we realized from the Dengvax shot that has happened 3 years ago, that there is a need for a community engagement, a kind of advocacy, a kind of vaccine communication. And in fact, Carmina, the media is a very powerful medium, or how do you call it, a platform for these things. Because we now realize with the COVID pandemic, you realize how people are now racing, you just mentioned it a while ago, how people, the scientists, are racing against time to come up with a vaccine. And I just realized now that what they were neglecting before, what they were taking for granted before, the vaccines, are now becoming the hot issue. Because indeed, we all know that 200 years of vaccination and vaccine development have contributed 95% of the global health today. Mind you, the vaccines, this is, you can look at this, 95% of global health today is actually credited to vaccine. And it has been here for 200 years. So what do we have to show for it if we are fearing vaccine? And this is because there are anti-vaxxers. We all know that. There are emerging anti-vaxxers, which actually originated in 1998 and has actually emerged because people just don't see the disease anymore that they were actually preventing. For example, measles. You know, we almost eliminated measles back then in 2005. When in fact we have been having 5,000 deaths from measles in the 90s, in the 80s. And then we almost eliminated it. No more measles. And then the vaccine hesitancy came because of the Dengvax, because people thought vaccines do harm. It does not.
Yeah,
vaccines are safe.
So,
vaccines are effective.
Yeah, so Dr. Bravo, as you said, we have enough time. There's, what, 6 to a year to get this communication campaign going. As a premier vaccinologist, as an expert on the matter, where do you begin?
We begin with you, Carmina. This is a beginning. It is, in fact, people able to be educated, able to come up with their concerns. You listen to them. You actually ask through research what you can do to have a conversation with them, convince them that it is, in fact, important that they be vaccinated. Do you know that in the Middle Ages, they do not name children who are born because half of them will die before their second birthday? But with the vaccines, then it started to have, we have children starting to grow up healthy. And in fact, the antibiotics came long after the vaccine. It was only in the early 1928, when Ian Fleming discovered penicillin. But vaccines have been here for more than 200 years.
So, Dr. Bravo,
we are really needing all the help of people to engage in people, to convince them, to converse with them that vaccines are safe, they work, they really are the ones that will save lives.
So clearly, Dr. Bravo, there are standards that should be followed in this mass vaccination that has yet to happen. But you're saying the conversation should start now as to how that will take place, how that will be realized. But in this race to secure and eventually distribute this vaccine, should there be space for geopolitics? I'm sure you know about, you know, these countries offering heads of state saying that they prefer one country's development over the other. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, Fermina, we always say politics and science have, you know, there's two sides to a coin. It can mix, but one should, politics, for example, should not be, you know, thinking of not believing in science. Science should be the basis for health policies. Science should be the basis. We all know politics is needed here because somehow to move forward a policy, like policy is politics, right? But this will all be based on science because otherwise it will be disastrous. It will be fatal. And we all know that. If you begin to come up with political and even some of these controversies that are actually overpowering sometimes, it is not good for the people. And we all know that kind of, we do research. We do this communication to the people in order to educate them. And let's listen to that. Mm-hmm. And I do hope, you know, there are some whose background may not be in science, but there are also social sciences that we need in order to really let them know there are people that need to be educated enough to make these policies work.
All right,
and they can work together if they just realize the enormous outcome, the enormous responsibility that all of our politicians have in order to save the lives of our people.
Dr. Lulu Bravo, Professor Emeritus of the UP College of Medicine and Executive Director of the Philippine Foundation for Vaccination. As always, thanks for joining us, and you keep safe.
Thank you, Carmina. You too. Take care.
You too.